So Destiny 2 still kind of sucks. Okay, this is probably the fourth or fifth time I tried to make this video, but fuck man, the state of the game currently is just so aggressively mundane that every time I start editing, I almost immediately lose interest and procrastinate to the extent where the points I bring up are either patched or irrelevant. And if I'm being perfectly honest, the thought of going back and stapling more relevant topics to a video already well within the editing stage sounded about as appealing as pretending to enjoy Anthem, so I opted to just scrap each attempt. But not this one, dammit. For all the shit Destiny deservedly gets, not even I can deny how much of a mainstay the game is in my library of looter games. I'm a Warframe junkie, I'm a Borderlands fanatic, I'm a Monster Hunter lover, but when there's nothing to do, when there's a content drought, Destiny is almost always there to catch me and keep me standing until the next big content update. But holy fuck, every time I think Destiny might be doing something good, they turn right back around to slap me in the face and tell me, "You're gonna keep playing our shit no matter what, so why should we even bother taking the extra step?" Hey, remember when they announced that the premium items you could get out of the Everest store could be reacquired and rerolled with non-premium currency? Yeah, so do I. Shame they conveniently forgot to mention that it was next to impossible to obtain most of the items in the store due to the scarcity of Bright Dust, combined with the fact that the only interesting cosmetics are overpriced to the high heavens. Oh, but we'll get to that later. But for now, we need to play a quick game of catch up and talk about the shit that came before the big Activision split and Shadowkeep's release. Now, I'd like to think that a big part of the reason I just couldn't seem to get the video done for so long is because I've been spending too much time on shit that I've either already talked about in my previous video, or stuff that doesn't need much time to talk about, period. So I'll try my best to stay as quick and concise as possible on at least the pre-Forsaken stuff, since I never really covered that area of Destiny 2's life. Anyway, I've stalled long enough. It's time to get this ball a-rolling. Destiny 2, the recap. Ready? Vanilla Destiny 2 was a fundamental failure on almost every level. The graphics were pretty and the music was divine, but the grind was boring. The PvP was fine, but in hindsight was still not that good. The raid was unrewarding. And the story?
I am God!
The story was deliciously dreadful. As if releasing a bad game wasn't enough, Bungie, deciding to go for the classic strategy of do literally everything in the worst conceivable way possible, was caught throttling XP in a blatant attempt to slow the grind for premium cosmetics to a crawl and push the sale of their pathetic loot boxes, pretended to fix the throttling by instead doubling the XP required to obtain even one of the loot boxes as though we're too stupid to notice, locked base game content from players who didn't fork over more money for the shitty expansions, and had the sheer, unmitigated, no pun intended, gall to release that godforsaken Christmas event meant not to spread that holiday cheer, but to milk their dwindling audience for as much cash as possible. You could write a novel with how much garbage Bungie shat out early in the game's sad, miserable existence. Pretty inconsequential compared to the fucking Stephen King collection of Fallout flavored fuck-ups a year later, but you get the idea. Shit was bleak in 2017. Oh, but you think it couldn't get much worse. Shut up, you don't exist yet. You think it couldn't get much worse? Oh, you poor, poor, misinformed soul. Indeed, it can get worse. Especially when we get to... Once upon a time, the Dark Below expansion was considered the worst investment of $20 Destiny ever had. Osiris would like to have a word with you. For the low, low... Seriously, it's not that much money, but we're looking at the price in context. Low price of $20, you get, and try to keep up, a boring new story that ultimately changes nothing about the universe at large or our investment in the mysterious character of the legendary warlock Osiris, a pitifully small patrol zone made tedious to navigate thanks to the inability to summon a vehicle and the lack of general shit to do, a handful of exotics, and a brand new raid. I'm sorry? Hold on, it's not a raid? Wait, it's a... What? It's a raid lair? The hell's the difference? Oh, it's shorter than a normal raid? And it's some of the Leviathan? Great. No, yeah. Great. Oh, but how about another $20 for the expansion Warmind? An almost equally bad expansion with a boring new story that ultimately changes nothing about the universe at large or our investment in a character who lore-wise is actually supposed to be dead, continuity be damned. A larger but equally boring patrol zone with only a single thing worth doing but was only reasonably doable with a non-matchmakable party of 7 to 9 players at the time, a handful of exotics, and a brand new... Raid Lair once again set aboard everybody's favorite planet-eating ship, the Leviathan. Ugh! Ironically, it's the free shit that came after the fact that wound up being the best part of Curse of Osiris and Warmind. The Whisper of the Worm quest, impressive armor and subclass buffs, the Whisper of the Worm quest, the Solstice of Heroes, the Whisper of the Worm quest, the Whisper of the Worm quest. Even the raids weren't that, raid layers weren't that bad, but they still never really quite reached the King's Fall or rather the Machine level of quality. But now, we can get to the first not-so-shit expansion Destiny 2's ever had, and let me make it perfectly clear where I stood with Destiny 2 at this point. After the majority of Warmind's content became available, Destiny 2 had a solid blueprint for what could become a great future for the game despite the last two expansions. It still sucked, but what it needed was a little nurturing, its edges round, and some general polishing to finally break out of this tremendously terrible stage. The next expansion was meant to be that polish, so Bungie couldn't afford to make Forsaken just good. They needed to knock it out of the park with this one. So, without further ado.
Duh.
Forsaken is bad. No, I'm not sorry, and I'm not joking. Forsaken is just fucking bad. Not only did the hype following Forsaken and Bungie's marketing likening the expansion to Destiny's The Taken King, an actual turning point for the mundane life of the first game, work against Forsaken's own merits, but the story and the lack of good content at launch made Forsaken a chore to play through. Destiny 2 was in a better spot than it used to be, sure, but that amounts to nothing if the game is still tedious and boring. Not to mention, all this expansion manages to do is bring Destiny 2 close, to the state the previous game was in, unceremoniously bringing us back to square one. Let's start from the beginning.
No, but I do have a bullet with your name on it. Oh,
any second now, my partner is gonna roll in here and kill every last one of you. And you, my man.
This is going to hurt. A lot. Any last words?
How's your sister?
And there goes my investment. No, not just because Cade, I'm the only remotely competently written character in the entire franchise 6, is killed off in the opening cutscene of the supposed turning point of this disaster of a game, but mostly because it's just not shocking or unexpected. Bungie spoiled this in their very first teaser trailer for Forsaken. I know they think they were changing the game with a personal revenge story in a game about space knights and wizards who worship a giant floating plot MacGuffin, but the early reveal of the death of the only actual character in the game, especially in the wake of Destiny 2's troubled life up to that point, reeks of desperation. But anyway, back to the story. You and Cade are enlisted to help Petravenge quell a riot in the Prison of Elders, but it'll be revealed later that there's more to this riot than initially believed. You'll notice a pattern with expansions like this, where the opening mission paints such a promising picture only for the rest of the experience to fall 10 feet into a bat of aardvark manure. You and Cade are barreling through hordes of familiar enemies, Cade's doing some flashy shit and commenting directly on your character's performance, and despite not really doing anything too alien from what you usually do in Destiny, that being shooting stuff and making things explode into particle effect confetti, the spectacle and the nice set piece design makes this mission tolerable. At least until this bullshit. I've tried. I really have, but Bungie has had their ears plugged since the launch of Destiny 2, so I'm just not gonna bother wasting my time. After an awesome but needlessly long cutscene, we're introduced to the new enemy type called the Scorn. They're fallen, but they're zombies. Yep. Now, if you've seen my previous video on Destiny 2, you'd probably be aware that I'm not overly fond of the Taken faction, but fighting them is probably the only time in Destiny's entire history that I've ever felt the need to strategize, prioritize targets, or be smart with my abilities. I get similar vibes out of fighting the Scorn. Each of their units has unique powers and abilities, the target prioritizing is encouraged, but unlike the Taken, who had a downright amazing introduction, the Scorn feel less like a looming threat and more like a token obligation for the new big expansion. Anyway, Cade's dead, but not before taking a stab at our lack of a voice.
Speechless. Typical.
Later we return to Brickwall Vala and Wood Plank Korra to mourn, and this happens.
I refuse to bury any more friends.
You won't have to. Aldrin Sov is mine.
Chilling, to say the least. You know what this means now, right? Our player character is no longer a voiceless husk for us to project ourselves onto. They have their own voice, a personality. They have agency over the story portrayed through their voice and actions rather than awkwardly through their ghost. I mean, they'd have to have some serious grade A steel Herculean balls to try something like, I don't know, having one of the few lines of dialogue spoken by the player character placed in the trailer revealing the return of their voice to falsify the idea that they have more agency over the story than they actually do. Right? They wouldn't do something that monumentally stupid and undermine the goodwill they've built hyping this expansion, right? Right? Two. There were two total lines of dialogue spoken by your player character throughout the entire campaign. Neither of which, mind you, were spoken during your final encounter with Cade's murderer, Prince Aldrin. We'll get to that in a bit, but before I have a fucking aneurysm over the garbage I just went over, let's get to the main undercooked meat of the campaign, the Baron Hunt. Tell me, does it sound fun to spend 4 hours fighting effectively the same boss over and over again, repeating the same stupid formula of damage boss, immunity add clear phase, damage boss, immunity add clear phase, over and over and over again, fighting the exact same way and using the same boring tactics over and over and over and over again? No? Well, you better find some fun somewhere in that because you're gonna be doing that for the whole fucking game. I'm not kidding. Almost every boss in Forsaken is exactly the same. The only one that is slightly different is the Rider. But that fight can be made trivial by hopping off your vehicle, whipping out a sleeper, and nuking the bitch out of existence. None of the Barons do anything interesting with their concepts or incorporate their gimmicks into their fights. The Trickster's shtick is that she disguises explosives as desirable items like heavy ammo and even exotic engrams, but none of this is incorporated into her boss fight. I'll do you one better. I like the idea of disguising ammo and exotic engrams as explosives, but the way they're implemented now makes them seem less like a clever trick and more like a tedious annoyance. So what you could have done is instead of ammo boxes exploding and doing no damage, make it so rigged ammunition is still loaded into your weapon but it's flagged as false ammo and if you don't spend it, it explodes and deals damage proportional to the amount of false ammo you grabbed, capping at near fatal damage. For rigged engrams, instead of just having it materialize in your hands when you're first introduced to the idea, have it actually show up in your inventory and give you a small window to open your menu and delete it before it explodes and kills you. Then you can have a part of the boss fight where the Trickster drops an avalanche of false engrams on top of you and you're forced to dodge or risk needing to find cover and clean your inventory before you die. Would these be good ideas in execution? I don't know, I'm not a game designer, but I bet I put more thought into how to make a compelling boss fight than anyone who actually worked on the campaign did. Speaking of boss fights, Nani the fuck? Okay, let me get this straight. You set up this whole spiel about Forsaken primarily being a revenge story about a character hunting and killing the murderer of the only liked character in the whole franchise, and instead of ending the campaign in a climactic final duel between you and Aldrin, you decided to... I'm still trying to wrap my head around this. You decided to end this personal revenge story with a battle against a fucking hentai tentacle meatball. this thing. Not Uldren. Not even some souped up mecha version of him. This fucking thing. No, I don't have time. I do not have time, and I'm not going to bother. I'm over it. This story's a fucking disaster and a waste of time. I know it technically continues with the Dreaming City Curse plotline and the Last Wish raid and Raven and blah, 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 blah. You know what? I value preserving my sanity a hell of a lot more than scouring the depths of Destiny fucking 2 to find the vaguest hints of good storytelling. So for now, we're done with that shit. Let's instead talk about something I briefly mentioned a second ago. How about that Last Wish raid? It was pretty great. What? Were you expecting me to just label something as bad, even though most players you'd ask would almost unanimously agree is good? Nope. I sincerely mean it when I say The Last Wish was the best raid we've had since King's Fall. Emphasis on was. Nowadays, I can't be asked to even bother with it. No, it wasn't ruined by bugs. They didn't mess with the loot or anything. Not in a negative way, at least. No, it was ruined by the player base. Yeah, I get it. It's not fair to blanket such a good raid with the rest of what makes Forsaken a bad expansion just because the players ruined it. Player behavior ruins games all the time, just look at just about any first-person shooter. But I don't think there's a better place to talk about this because Bungie's response to this kind of behavior is damning for the future of their raid content. The Last Wish was butchered by cheese and exploits. You can't scroll through the PC LFG Discord for more than a second without seeing Riven cheese times 3. You're almost guaranteed to trip over people booping Eyes of Riven out of their spawn rooms to instantly complete a charge in the vault. You basically have to flip a fucking coin if you want a group that doesn't trap Callie. But Mr. Hebrew, don't you want to finish the raid quickly? You get your loot faster, stop being such a meaty bobini and take your loot. Fuck off, if there's anything Bungie has always done right with their raids, even the bad ones, is how thrilling it is to take the challenge provided by these raids, showing Atheon, Crota, Oryx, Axis, Kallus, Argos, Kaor, and Riven, yes I know all of them by fucking heart, who's boss, and being rewarded for a job well done with another fucking Apex Predator. I swear to god, if it's another Genesis auto-loading holster roll, I'm gonna throw a goddamn gun. The point is, I like playing through these raids. I like taking on these challenges and beating them through wit and teamwork. Do you know how you beat Riven? You take 5 or 6 swords, you walk up to her big disgusting hand, and you give her the manicure of a lifetime. No splitting the team into groups, no cleansing symbols, no popping eyes or popping pimples. 6 swords, 1 bubble, no shame. At least this cheese is more interesting than fucking cluster bomb rockets. But what kills it for me is that this apparently has Bungie's blessing. So not only is the community at large hell-bent on taking the game out of video game, but not even Bungie respects their own raid design when they deserve it. Fucking hell, dude. Well, if there's anything that wasn't ruined over time in Forsaken's lifetime, it's the new PvEvP game mode Gambit. I know, at least according to the Destiny 2 player base, opinions are split on this game mode. Even I felt a little iffy about it being a weird hybrid mode for PvE and PvP. Destiny has always had a problem balancing PvE to have strong loadout options and PvP to make sure those same options didn't break player engagements. Newsflash, Bungie, contrary to what you might think, you cannot balance PvE in the same way you balance PvP. You mess with a weapon because it causes problems in PvP, but does not share the same problems in PvE, people won't like it, and you create a cascade of problems that you stubbornly refuse to acknowledge as problems, so give me back my god-tier Skull of Dire Ahamkar, you fucking cunt! I've never been overly fond of Destiny's PvP. Then again, I'm not really that big of a PvP fan to begin with, but I have a particular distaste for the Crucible. But in my opinion, Destiny's PvP is always at its best when it takes the obligatory FPS arena style they were known for with Halo, throwing it to the wayside, and embracing the ludicrous nature of wizards chucking beach ball-sized supernovas and rogues littering the battlefield with flaming knives. Mayhem and Gambit are the results of this embrace. I won't go into detail about Mayhem, since the idea of a game mode with super fast ability recharges is pretty self-explanatory and also hilariously entertaining, but I'm actually quite fond of Gambit. Most people I know who've complained about the mode complained about the invaders and how busted overpowered they can be, myself included for a time. Yeah, it's annoying to get nuked by another fucking blade barrage, but I think that's kind of the point of invading. They're supposed to be annoying, a thorn in your side, an obstacle in the race to summon and kill your primeval first. I think the reason I like Gambit as much as I do is that despite having Destiny's PvP elements, you don't engage with those elements enough for it to get frustrating. You're not spending an entire match wondering when you're gonna get deleted by some random fuck who pressed their instant kill button before you could conceivably react, because you know when an invader's coming and have ample time to prepare. They're threatening when they inevitably show up with their supers and heavy ammo, but you've had time to dunk your modes or grab the ammo you need to compete with them. That's the point. Invaders are meant to be that annoying pest to slow your progress by any means necessary. Denying modes, healing bosses, or just hanging around.
Menacingly!
To scare the other team and make them waste precious time. That's what they're meant to do. I don't know. Maybe I'm just a weirdo who likes these strange PvP modes that don't conform to the competitive norms regardless of whether or not they're conceived well, and I'm just too bad at the game and should kill myself. But it'd be horribly disingenuous of me to deny the fun I've had with Gambit. I would get into detail about the new super abilities and how fun they are to use, despite there being a clear skewing toward warlocks and general usefulness, but we spent plenty of time in Forsaken already, and we need to get to the annual pass content so we can get to the relevant stuff, so... For those of you who weren't around at the time, partially thanks to the fact that you've basically been given half of the good shit for free, Bungie released the totally not a second season pass, but is another season pass following the first season pass, thus making it a second season pass called the Annual Pass, which included three mini expansions priced at $35 and all had their own new way to grind for loot, while basically ignoring any attempt at telling another half-baked and boring story. Sounds fantastic, but there's only one itsy bitsy little problem. If you only really cared to play through Season of the Forge and Season of the Drifter, and couldn't give a toss about Season of Opulence, well, tough shit, you're paying for all of it. No piecemeal purchasing for you. This was just a massive backhand to the face and almost immediately put a sour taste in everyone's mouths. They may have abandoned that nonsense for the time being, but let's just say that Jimmy's have been viciously rustled. Speaking of paying for shit that I have no interest in playing, let's get to the content, shall we? And try to keep up, because we're moving to the quickfire round.
Also, we need to hurry up and get to Shadowkeep.
Ready? Here we go. The Season of the Forge is fine, I guess. The forges are neat to play around in, the new loot is pretty cool, and the raid is okay, but they decided to pull an Eater of the Spire of the Lord of the Chamber of the Rise of the and it's over before you can say Season of the Drifter had no raid and was therefore a complete waste of time.
Anyway, Season of the Drifter had no raid and therefore was a complete waste of time. Look, I like Gambit as much as the next guy, but I simply must understand the headspace that you have to be in to base an entire expansion around a single competitive mode that a significant portion of your audience will not care about. That's not just me saying that. Almost everyone I've spoken to regarding Sod did exactly what I did and dipped from the game entirely during this season. But hey, we got Thorn out of the bargain, so all's forgiven, I guess. Next!
I have no clever segue for Season of Opulence, so I'll just state plainly that it's the best of the three annual pass expansions. The Menagerie and the accompanying Chalice makes for a fabulous loot farm, as it gives players more control over their loot than normal. The Crown of Sorrow raid, following tradition apparently, is A-OK, if not short, and a total clusterfuck near the end. And the motherfucking bad juju's back, baby!
Got all that? Good, because we're finally topping off for this video with... This was it. This was their big moment. This was Bungie's time to shine. This was the chance Bungie needed to prove that they can not only handle the Destiny franchise well for the foreseeable future, but to also do it alone, without the backing of Activision. They made the base game free to play. They announced positive changes to the Eververse store, which now had a better reason to be in the game than ever before. They consolidated all of the annual pass content into a single bundle with Forsaken.
Which inadvertently stepped over the people who paid for that content, but let's not split hairs on unnecessary evil.
And they even hinted that this model would be replicated for future content, and possibly even Destiny 3. So with all of this fantastic news leading up to the launch of Destiny's first non-publisher-backed expansion, did Shadowkeep live up to the hype? You know, disappointment must be in Bungie's nature, because Shadowkeep may be the biggest ripoff since The Dark Below. Remember when I said Bungie had this bad habit of hiding their incoming backhand behind the veil of a good change? Shadowkeep is the antithesis of that habit. For just about everything this expansion does right, it does at least one more thing wrong. And possibly the most egregious of all is Shadowkeep's story, so what better way to kick off our grand finale with this utter con job of a narrative? So we start off by investigating some strange hive activity on the- Do I have to do this? Come on, we all know what we're in for. Do I really need to get into this? No, you know what? I'm not even going to consider putting in the extra effort. If Bungie's allowed to take shortcuts and be lazy, then so am I. The story of Shadowkeep can't even be considered a story by any reasonable standards. Anyone who has the most basic knowledge of storytelling knows that every story has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Shadowkeep has no ending, and the plot goes as thus. Eris Morn did a big dumb, Moon's haunted, big pyramid things from Vanilla Destiny 2 campaign are big spooky and implied to be the cause of the collapse.
We are your salvation.
And that's it, the story stops. It didn't end, nothing was learned, nothing was expanded upon, no big bad boss fights. The story literally just stops, dead in its tracks. You give Eris the relic thing and she tells you that she'll at you when she thinks of more shit to do. Verbatim, that's actually what she said. When the story's not pissing me off or battering my ears with subpar voice acting,
run.
It's testing my patience with a fucking shopping list of bullshit busy work in place of actual story moments.
Bungie, just fucking stop. Stop trying to write stories, stop teasing shit that goes nowhere, stop wasting your time making this shit, and stop wasting our time by forcing us to participate in this legal torture just so we can get to the shit that people actually want to play. And no, you sit down. I know who you are. Get your hands off that keyboard. I refuse to accept that the story continues in the raid. Get that trash out of here and shut your fuckhole. Actually, since we're on the topic, the Garden of Salvation raid is pretty fucking good. At least until we get to the Gate Lord from Destiny 1. Shit, I'm sorry. I mean, one of the last three bosses from Destiny 1. Fuck, man, I'm sorry again. I mean, Atheon from Destiny 1. God damn it, man. I mean, one of the many Vex Minotaur bosses from Destiny 2, and then it just becomes an annoying chore. I mean, I enjoy the tethering mechanics and the moat collecting and stuff, but shit gets so convoluted during the boss fight that it almost always becomes a battle between you, the boss, the mechanics, and worst of all, the other players. People open portals that they aren't supposed to, people will almost without fail intercept the tether teams when they're trying to build a lost platform or start DPS phase. Occurrences like this are so fucking common that you will have to deal with them at some point if you at all give a shit about raiding in this game. I know that basically turned into me complaining about the raid, but I just can't help it. It's still a good raid. In addition to the raid, Shadowkeep, like the previous three expansions, introduces new loot grinds in the form of the Lectern of Enchantment, which functions sort of like the chalice from the previous season, the Altar of Sorrow, which is a sort of open-world horde mode in the same vein of Escalation Protocol, the Pit of Heresy dungeon, and the new horde mode but not really horde mode called the Vex Offensive, a repetitive but heavily rewarding seasonal activity to supplement the main chunk of content. Only because we can't have nice things, at least not for very long, if you didn't participate in the Vex Offensive during the Season of Undying in one of those armor and weapons, get fucked. The mode is gone, snapped out of existence, forever lost to time. No, Guardians don't make their own fate and you get nothing. Now you gotta play this menagerie knockoff called the Sundial and pretend as though you didn't just have content you paid for taken away from you. Fucking classy. Actually, since we're on the subject of seasonal activities, Shadowkeep is the first to introduce Destiny's version of the Battle Pass, because literally everything needs a damn Battle Pass these days. Granted, the Battle Pass may be the best invention of the modern games industry since the Nintendo Switch. I know it's gratuitous to copy competitors with less interesting and sometimes objectively worse versions of monetization tactics, but I'll take a Battle Pass over loot boxes or microtransactions any day. Fuck. Anyway, the way Destiny does it is fine, I guess. If you don't pay for the expansion, you're still able to unlock the seasonal exotic weapon, it just takes a little longer, and if you do pay for the expansion, then you gain access to neat armor and weapon ornaments, exclusive emotes, and some rather neat stuff like finisher animations. I actually really enjoy the new finisher system, but I'm a little lost as to the purpose of it. I mean, finishers look cool, sure, but the health threshold to trigger them is so low that they're not much better than taking some of this and doing a lot of this. I mean, they're good against champions and other tough yellow barred enemies, but being good against a comparatively small number of enemy types is like, I don't know, being good at cutting hedges with a chainsaw. I mean, yeah, it works, but you could just use hedge cutters or something. Speaking of champions, each of these new seasons also carry with them a relic which lets you use special mods that let you combat against the unique abilities of champions, and also adds a unique effect to the weapon and class abilities that you can't find anywhere else. This, along with the new mod system, was done in an attempt to encourage build diversity, as Bungie made the bold claim that they'd go hardball into RPG territory from Shadowkeep onward. Unfortunately, Bungie still doesn't seem to want to put in the legwork. Every time a season changes, the previous relic disappears along with its mods and is replaced by another one with slightly different mods but functionally the same damn things, they're just on different weapons and based around different elemental subclasses. Okay, so why would I even bother with these seasonal mods and the relic in general if you're just gonna take them away months later? Build diversity my ass, you're just doing the same stupid you will play the way we tell you whether you like it or not nonsense that you've always done. Look, I think someday Destiny can be that one step below Warframe level of RPG someday, and that would be a fantastic place for the game to be in. But Bungie, you need to throw away that useless pride of yours and do what needs to be done to make Destiny a game and a franchise we all can enjoy for what it is. First, stop trying to tell compelling stories. You're not good at it, and you've never done anything to show that you ever will be. Put those resources to better use. Second, stop with this flavor of the month patchwork bullshit. Nobody likes it. All you're doing is removing options for your players and reinforcing this terrible attitude you forced your players to have, where if you don't bring a whale as a warlock, you're a bad teammate. And to add to that, separate PvE and PvP balance. I know you want a uniform experience throughout the game, but you are fundamentally wrong if you think you can balance a weapon in PvE the same way you do in PvP. Take this phrase to heart, Bungie. If it ain't broke, don't fucking fix it. Now give me back my Skull of Dire Kumquat. Third,
put more focus into raids and dungeons. Almost 100% of my fondest memories of the Destiny franchise was made during a raid or a dungeon. I will never forget my first time getting a Vex Mythoclast, my first completion of King's Fall, my first flawless run in Crota's End. Finding and finishing the secret Whisper of the Worm quest after having the weapons returned teased for so long was magical. And the Shadowed Throne was pretty neat too. Honestly, if you were to just keep releasing expansions with just a raid and a couple dungeons each, I'd pay for every single one of them. I even find myself enjoying the bad raid simply because of how much enjoyment we can all get out of laughing out of the ridiculousness of a fucking stealth section in a game about space wizards who know subtlety about as well as a Michael Bay film. And fourth, and most important step of all, I mean it, Bungie, perk your ears up and listen carefully, because not doing so could send the universe into chaos. Dogs and cats would rain from the sky, up would be down, left would be right, Spider-Man would be taken from the MCU, and Trump might not get impeached! Okay. The fourth and most important step of all is to give me back my ball of fire kind of.
Also, I rate the free-to-play Destiny 2 New Light a C and a B- with all the expansions. See you when I upload in 10 years.